I think the police have just walked in. Had the police all walked in? Somebody tell me if they walked in. Well, don't sit there stoned. Tell me, are the cops here? Do we gotta stop now? Hey, we're all dead.
Outrageous is the name of the album, and I think that pretty much sums it up. Kim Fowley, that track is by, and that has been brought in by Julian Cope. Welcome to the Freak Zone, Julian.
Stuart, it's great to see you.
How are you doing?
I'm achieving.
Good. What is it about Kim Fowley, should I ask you first, that speaks to you?
Bad vocal technique.
Is that it?
Yeah, bad vocal technique, bad mic technique to rival the call and answer bit that Lou Reed does on The Gift.
Oh, yeah.
Sneakily Pomper! I've never used a mic before.
We played it last week.
Oh,
the Gift on the show. We played The Gift just last week.
That's brilliant.
Hey, well, let's talk about the big thing that's happening with you at the moment, and that's the release of your new book, The Megalithic European, which is a hefty tome and follows on some, what, about 8 or 9 years later from Modern Antiquarian?
Actually, six.
Six?
Yeah.
I do beg your pardon.
Nah, it's coming.
My maths isn't what it was. No, unlike you, I think I'd like to operate on a different kind of time.
Yeah, yeah. You come in with me. I've got my own fiscal year going.
Have you?
Yeah.
So... have the intervening period, those intervening 6 years, been spent tramping the, you know, highways and byways and seeking out men ears in all across Europe?
Yeah. As has become almost my mantra, I've been told to piss off in almost every Indo-European language.
And for anyone who's foolish enough not to know what we're talking about the fact that this is the European version, or the expanded kind of European vista of your original book, Modern Antiquarian, which was looking at the... pre-Christian holy sites of, well, in that case, Britain, I guess.
Yeah, heathen Britain.
Heathen Britain, yeah.
Yeah.
And what kind of things are we talking about? Stone circles?
Stone circles, rows of stones, great big mounds with ancestral burials used to sort of, you know, speak the law on top, you know, to keep control.
Yeah.
Sort of... strange earth circles, places where people sort of, invoked whichever god they were worshipping that year.
Yeah, yeah. And a lot of them, I was noticing when I was reading the book, there seem to be certain areas seem to have a predisposition to have them. Spain, there's a lot in Spain, isn't there?
Yeah, they're very much local places.
Yeah.
And that's what I like about it, is it was quite interesting to discover that we do this and we don't have any of that. And they do this, and down there they do that. And, you know, we're an island culture, so we only do this.
Yeah.
They're very, very tight on it.
Yeah.
And the whole reason I did it was because it really just showed how similar we are to the people of the past.
Right.
And I thought that was really essential, because I think we spend half of our time feeling guilty about, you know, you're driving too much and, you know, you've got to stop. It's like, well, they were screwing up years ago.
Right, okay. Oh, right, so you don't take the viewpoint that they were in a kind of heightened state and were terrible by comparison?
I get the impression that they were just like us.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, they screwed their own landscape up.
Yeah.
Just becoming obsessive. You know, it's like, I really like this jade axe. Can we have another one? Yeah, can we have another one? Yeah, can we have another? Look, there's 106 in this burial chamber. We can't get any more in. That's very modern to me.
Yeah. Oh, you're absolutely right. Yeah. So perhaps it shows that there are distinctly human traits.
Yes. That's the thing. I'm not a golden ager, as far as I'm concerned.
Oh,
what this was about was, once upon a time, we felt a real sense of kinship to the land. And as far as I'm concerned, this is when we were moving out of it into what we are now. And that's why it speaks to me. Because it's so deeply rock.
It is deeply rock. Is this that you do now, is this your life's calling, do you think, or is it just one part of all the things you do? Do you consider yourselves, you know, rock and roller, shaman, guide to pre-Christian Europe?
Absolutely, forward slash blur. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I just reckon, okay, being a historian is great because it gives you a sense of where you are now. And the essential thing about this is that by recognizing that they were screwing up royally 5,000 years ago, it makes you feel less neurotic about where you're at now. And the other thing is by you can reach certain universal human traits by going back into the past and seeing what we were doing then and discovering that there are certain ways out of that dilemma, because by knowing what was going on before, you can see exactly the same problems and work through it this way. And I think that's essential.
We'll probably say a little bit more about that part of what you do, but let's talk about rock and roll for a second. You brought in Outrageous by Kim Fowley, and we played Chinese Water Torture from this. Do you want to set up and tell a little about what the track we're going to hear now about, which I gather is about Vietnam and speed and all manner of things?
Yeah, this is like the best power trio out of the South Pacific.
Right. And they are called?
They're called Speed, Glue and Shinky. And they're named after the names of the members of the band. And what it was started by Joey Smith, Joey Speed Smith.
Nice.
Who was a drummer who sings a lot like Iggy. But the main reason he went to Okinawa after Vietnam was because it was the place with the cheapest amphetamines in the whole South Pacific. He met up with Shinky Chen, who was the Japanese Hendrix, who introduced him to Glue, the man who glues it all together, the bass player, and they formed this band dedicated to songs which Joey Smith wrote all about scoring enormous amounts of cheap speed, and that was their entire singular muse. He died very few years later, but there were certain results, and this is one of them. This is Sniffing and Snorting.
I'm fairly sure that when that bass was recorded, the needles were going slightly into the red.
Oh, yeah.
Don't you think, Julian?
I think it's quite possible with this
That's terrific.
Artist.
You've got to admire the single-mindedness of that trio, just writing every song about the same subject.
Stoned Out of My Mind, I thought, well, there was a track called Stoned Out of My Mind.
Yeah.
I thought, oh, no, but he's stoned on speed.
Well, there you go.
And he makes it very clear at the end, because at the end, he slows the whole track down and he goes, hey, you over there, you want to buy some speed?
Yeah, of course. Not, of course, that we are condoning that here on the Freak Zone because of the unique way that we're funded. So what do you do when you're not traipsing around Europe looking at large stones? I mean, do you still consider yourself a rock and roller?
Totally, I am.
We should talk about, we should talk about your fantastic website, which has introduced me to lots of top music, which is Head Heritage. Yeah, tell me about that. I look out for Album of the Month and all those things and those great reviews that people post. Tell me how that little community's come to exist.
Well, the way that I saw Head Heritage was, there were a lot of places where people could post, but ultimately it was totally by kissing the butt of the guy who hosted the site.
Sure.
Yeah. And I just thought, no. What you got to do is you've just got to be, this is a free speech thing. People can post any crap. And, you know, somebody even reviewed Inagada Davida at 45.
That's right. I read that review.
It's good as well.
It works really well.
And every so often my webmaster gets a bit clucky and he'll go, there's no such thing as a Rare Pet Shop Boys album, is there? That's an oxymoron, Rare Pet Shop Boys. And I go, why? And he goes, somebody's reviewed it on Unsung. Should I take it off? And I go, no.
No.
Absolutely. Put it on. Free speech.
Yeah, yeah. And what about as a performing rock and roller? I mean, you do often do spoken word tours now, and lecture and things like that. I mean, are there enough hours in the day for you to do the stuff that's kind of teeming to get out?
No, I've had to start including employing the Victorian Long Minute to slow everything down.
The Victorian Long Minute?
Yeah, yeah.
Tell me about that.
Well, because I employ my own fiscal year. Right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, moved into Wiltshire and found this, like, little seam, like a little cosmic portal, and sneak through there, and then found that by employing the Victorian Long Minute, the 24-hour day is 27 minutes longer.
That's fantastic. We should post on the website how to engineer your life according to the Victorian Long Minute. That is fantastic. And what kind of people, when you do a spoken word gig, when you do your gigs, which are kind of part song, part lecture, would you call it lecture?
I never mix the two.
Oh, okay.
No, I never mix the metaphor.
Never do. No. Don't dilute the message.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, it's never, and therefore Stonehenge was finished and here's treason.
Yeah. Do you have two, are there two different members of the Julian Cope constituency? Are there people who respect you as a historian of pre-Christian Europe and the people who remember you as, you know, a raging rock and roller?
Oh man, it's a really weird one, right? Because I reckon there's a lot of, my audience is like 18 to 70.
Yeah.
And I have to admit, the 18, 19, 20-year-olds are all kind of archaeological students.
That's so cool.
It's really weird. And the 70-year-olds are all like, you know, but fans of that, you know. But it seems to be sort of coagulating into one big thing just by my keeping on it. And I think a lot of it is just sustaining that, you know, eventually people are beginning to accept my metaphor.
Yeah.
You just got to keep on it. You know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Do you ever consider going into politics? I don't.
My wife always says, keep on the program. Yeah, she's New York, right?
She's
like, keep on the program. Are you on the program? Okay. And so as soon as the Megalithic European is finished, it's like, I finished it. I'm so pleased. I'm still sort of sweating from all the places that I've been to. And we, and I think keeping on the program, I couldn't be diverted the way a politician would inevitably be diverted. It's the same thing. I've been asked to speak at every archaeological university, and I say to every lecturer, I'm not trying to preach to archaeological students because they've got no world view. They're just going to be like, whatever. I'm trying to talk to people who know something and have a bit of an experience about life.
Right.
So if I'm saying, look, I've been here and here and here, what do you think, da, 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 da. The most important thing is to talk to lecturers. But talking to a bunch of students who, you know, would rather be getting laid down the corridors on drugs,
sure.
I'd rather think, well, no, I won't be that old git.
Yeah. Okay. That brings me back around to rock and roll again. Another one of your choices now is by an artist I'm not really au fait with, Lord Baltimore.
Sir Lord Baltimore.
I detitled him.
Absolutely.
Man.
Well, the reason that they are Sir Lord Baltimore.
Oh, it's a group.
Typically American.
Yeah.
Is what's the way to be aristocratic in the American style, right? It's like, well, you'd have to be Lord Baltimore. But no, we're even more aristocratic. We're Sir Lord Baltimore. So they're a power trio.
Okay.
Overachieving to the max. This is a song about the drumming singer goes out, meets a prostitute who says, you're not going to be worth anything. And he says, I'm so sexually active that I'm going to be all you'll ever want. So good that you won't want to be a prostitute anymore. You'll only want to be with me. And he succeeds.
I feel Sean McFly will be covering it soon.
Yeah.
Hey, Sir Lord Baltimore, to give them the full title, and Lady of Fire, that is from, what's the album called, Julian? Kingdom Come is the name of the album. Julian, what's coming up? Because I asked you this because you just told me you're doing something quite exciting with the band Sun, are you?
Yeah, we're doing, I'm doing a gig in Athens with Sun. They're doing like a long trip out doom show.
This is a band I've become intrigued by from your website, Head Heritage, and it's a kind of music that you're quite into at the moment, isn't it? What would you call it?
I call it ambulant. Because it's like beyond ambience to the point where he's like, do you need an ambulance?
Yeah, yeah. But is kind of all the various subgenres of metal, is that something that you like? You're a big Sabbath fan, aren't you? Yeah.
I'm a huge Sabbath fan, but what it is really is that it's useful. I'm so into rock and roll as usefulness.
Oh, right, okay.
To me, if it's not useful, I can't listen to it. It's bourgeois and unnecessary.
What are the uses that you apply, say, ambient metal to?
Well, I got into ambient metal as much as anything because I was meditating to Japanese speed metal. And my wife came in this one day and she said, look, you've got the headphones on. Japanese speed metal is ideal to meditate to because it's all mid-range. So there's no bass and there's no top end to sort of, you know, disorientate you. You're just kind of, from the moment you kicks it.
Yeah.
And all I was doing, I was taking in Japanese speed metal tracks to my mate's studio and saying, loop it. And make it 27 minutes long, because they were like 2.5 minutes long.
Yeah.
And in the end, Dorian said to me, you know what, there's a place for this. So I did an album called Ambient Metal.
Yeah.
By my ambient metal band, LAMF.
Yeah.
And all it was incredible amounts of metal cliche with no drums.
Yeah.
And then this band Sun got in touch with me and they said, we do a thing called, well, we call it ambient grunge, actually, and we're from Seattle and here you go. And I got really friendly with them, and they're extremely smart, and again, they're into it as a useful thing. And all they do is they've just got two detuned Les Pauls, a bass player who kind of fusses about up here, and all the bass itself is created by a G4 PowerBook.
Great.
And they all wear these kind of big habits.
Yeah.
And they go on stage and, you know, it's like, in tone.
We're going to get them on the Freak Zone very soon. That's in December. What's anything coming up before then?
Until then, I'm doing the spoken word thing.
Chiefly.
I'm just finishing off an album that I've been bigging up since the late 90s called Citizen Kane.
Yeah.
The only problem with Citizen Kane is, in the meantime, I've become so informed by entirely sort of unrighteous sounds.
Right, okay.
That, there are three ballads on the new album, and the shortest one's 9:50.
Okay.
So I might as well forewarn people, you know, anybody who, the last vestiges of cope are disappearing fast.
We'll put all the details of all the stuff on the website. Julian, it is always a pleasure.
That's great to see you, man. You're looking quite gothic, you know.
Am I?
No, I think so, yeah.
It was a bit of an accident, but, you know, maybe I'll stick with it.
Is there such a thing as an accident, Stuart?
Do you think it was just... And honour thy accidents as a hidden intention, as Brian Eno said.
I think so, yeah. I've returned to black. Okay. Yeah, I'm going through. I've been in the flat field and I'm staying there.
Fantastic. Julian, thank you ever so much for coming by.
Great to see you. Take care.